We bring greetings in the wonderful and worthy name of Jesus. It's been such a blessing to worship together and to be encouraged in the things of God. Just also count it a real privilege and a blessing to worship together with like-minded believers, even though I hardly know any of you. But I sense the kindred spirit, and that's just one of those wonderful blessings we have of being children of God. We can go everywhere, anywhere we want, across the whole face of the earth, and find such a blessing of just sharing and fellowshipping together. Lord laid a message on my heart. The title of it is, A Way When There Is No Way. It's somewhat of I'm not sure if it really sounds logical. A way when there is no way. But you know, how many times do we often find in life that we come to a point in life where we just don't see any way out? I believe if you've got any years on your life or any experiences that you've gone through, you've come to those places at times when you just felt that there is really no way out. And so what do we do in those type of cases? And I'd like to go to Exodus of 13th, the 14th chapter, and preach from this portion of Scripture where Moses had been leading the children of Israel out of Egypt. This was a group of people, over 2 million people, and they had been delivered from Egypt, from their bondage, in a very, very miraculous way. And as they had left that night from Egypt, God led them over to the place called Succoth. And it says in verse 21 of chapter 13, and the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light to go by day and night. He took not away the pillar of cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. I imagine those people when they camped that first night with their families and with their children and with all their friends, as they had been delivered from that great bondage from Egypt, and they seen that pillar of cloud come among them, the presence of God. And they found out that this was God's presence to go with them from the land of bondage to the land of promise. I believe that night, those parents possibly pointed to that pillar of fire to their children and said, look, children, this is the God we're serving. He's going to take us from the land of bondage into the land of promise. And I believe those little children, as they laid their heads on their pillow, found a real comfort and a strength as they thought about that. But you know, they faced a test. The next day, as they left that pillar lifted, and they started going. And it says there in chapter 14, in verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel that they turn and encamp between Pahiroth, between Migdol and the sea, over against Baal Zephon. Before it shall ye encamp by the sea. You know, it would have been a lot quicker way to go to the land of promise if they would have gone another way. But God chose to lead them in another direction. And it's very interesting in this account. Here Moses was leading the people. And as they went, and the people followed Moses, they followed that cloud. All at once, they came to a place where it was called the Red Sea. And as they came to the shores of that Red Sea, as far as they could see, there was nothing but water. And they stood on those shores, I believe, and wondered, what is God doing? Why am I here at this place? There was no way. In fact, they say, I'm not sure if this is correct, but I read it. It says, the sea at the narrowest point was like 18 miles long, and at the shallowest point, it was like 162 feet deep. Here were 2 million people with their leader standing and looking across a vast expanse where they couldn't go anywhere. The mountain was on one side, and the desert was on the other. And they probably stood there perplexed. What is God doing? Why is he leading me to a point where there is no way? after all he has promised to me. And to compound the problem, we read that as they were standing there, probably looking in perplexity at this, in verse 10, Pharaoh, the mighty king of Egypt, with his mighty army, decided after they had left Egypt, left his hand of bondage, he decided to go after them. And as he went with his army and his chariots and all his mighty army, and as those children were looking, possibly some in the rear all at once noticed something far in the distance, and they all at once realized here was Pharaoh and his mighty army. And it caused a huge alarm among them because they knew what type of man this Pharaoh was. They knew what kind of army he had. And they knew the horribleness of being in bondage to him. And they just lost it, you might say. They started crying out. And they started being scared and afraid. And it went through that whole crowd. And I don't know what went through their mind, but they probably... Actually, yes, in verse 11, and they said unto Moses, I'll read verse 10, and when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians, for it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. You know, friends, this is a very common response when we face perplexities and when we think there is no way. We start blaming people. Have you ever experienced that? We start blaming people. If it wouldn't have been for him, if it wouldn't have been for him or her, I wouldn't be in this situation. They looked onto Moses and they said, you know, it would have been just so much better if you just left us alone. One time I heard my Uncle John Carnegie. He's from South Carolina. I don't know if you would have known him. He has a son, Virgil, who's bishop there in Blackville, South Carolina. Heard him give testimony. And he made a statement that I never forgot. He said, many times we ask God why. Instead, we should be asking what. What's God up to? Instead of just hanging on that thing of why. So I'd like to leave that with you today. When you're up against a situation where there's no way, instead of asking God why, ask him what. You know, really, Romans 8, verse 28 tells us that we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord and who are the called according to his purpose. There's a little three-letter word in that scripture. It says A-L. Do you and I really believe that? Do I believe in the sovereignty of God if I am his child? That anything that comes my way, God is in control and has a purpose. Those are the things that are hard. And I really thought about this scripture this saying. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am God. Do you realize the very thing that was bringing terror to the children of Israel's heart was God's hand? He hardened Pharaoh's heart to bring them after the children of Israel. And it was through that mighty miracle, the parting of the Red Sea, that their enemy was actually completely eliminated. But you see, you can't see it when there is no way in front of you. And when your problems are behind coming on to you, you just can't see it, can you? But I believe God this morning, whoever you are, whatever you're facing, wants us to, instead of crying out why, just crying out what. What are you trying to tell me? You know, but there was a difference in Moses. We don't see him being afraid. We don't see him struggling like those 2 million other people did. And I've wondered why, and yet I think we have the answer. If you go back to Exodus, the 6th chapter, one through eight, Moses had an encounter with God, and somehow he had his connection with the Lord. In verse 2, it says, God spake to Moses and said, I am the Lord. And he goes on to mention a few things. And I'm just simply going to give you an assignment. You read verse 7 and 8 sometime when you get home or whatever, and read how many I ams are in that scripture and what his promise was to Moses. And I believe that's what carried Moses through when he came to the place when there was no way. It's that connection with our Almighty Father. In fact, the Word of God tells us in Psalms, he says, Psalm 119, thought I had that. This is my comfort in my affliction, for thy word hath quickened me. I don't know of anything else, my friends, when we're up against the Red Sea, and we don't know a way out when we open the Word of God and we allow God's Word to minister to us. There's nothing that brings comfort and strength like this Word does. And there's something about it. And I'm just so thankful to be a child of His this morning. Where I, when we face those Red Sea experiences, that we can go into His Word and we can find the strength to go on when we really don't have any strength. And not only that, when we face those Red Sea experiences and we can reach out to God, we also have our brothers, our sisters, like-minded believers that can just reach out to us and give us strength. There's so much support in the Church of Jesus Christ, in the family of God, when we face those type of situations. I don't think that we realize the blessings and how God has designed His body, the blessings it brings to us. So many times we look on the negative side. So many times we face situations, and it's real, and it's true. We do. We're human. But, oh, there are so many blessings in that respect. As we go back to Exodus, the 14th chapter, I just love what Moses said here, as he turned around and he told his people. And Moses, this man of God that had his connection with God, he knew where to get his strength. He had that experience with God, and he got a hold of his promises. And this is what his ringing, victorious cry came back to the people of Israel. He said this way, "And Moses said unto the people, Fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom ye seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace." How many times do we try to figure things out on our own strength? And we try to fight our way through instead of just resting in God, doing what we know to do, doing what we ought to do, but then leave the results in God's hand. "And ye shall hold your peace." Oh, I love that. I trust that God would brand those scriptures into our hearts today as we go from this place and face the realities of life. The Lord shall fight for you. And of course, God, that night as they were camped there in the way where there was no way, he moved that pillar of cloud. Between God's people and the enemy, that precious Holy Spirit. For the enemy it was darkness, but for the children of his it was light. That night, I honestly believe when that pillar moved back between the enemy and the children of God, they were actually able to rest that night, even though there was no way. Can God make a way when there is no way? That's the question. Absolutely, he can. You know, another response sometimes that man faces, you know, he asks why, and he decides it'd just be better to return to Egypt. This life is too hard. Another one is, you find this in Job. After he experienced all his calamities, what did his wife suggest to him? She said, just die. Just die. Curse God and die. And I'm sorry to tell you that many times the devil gets people convinced that the only way out when there is no way in this earth is to take their own life. My friends, that is not the solution in any way, shape, or form. It's only the beginning of more terrible, terrible horrors. But you know, that's native to human nature when they finally come up against where they do not know any way out. My friends, this morning, if you're struggling with those things, even the thought of suicide or whatever it might be, don't be ashamed to share those things. Those things can be native. Can be part of our human nature. We're trying to figure a way out when there is no way. But God wants us to look to him for a way out. God wants us to look to him for the solution. You know, it seems like man can face many, many difficult things, experience a lot of heartaches if he has it figured out what's at the end. But when man cannot figure out what's happening and doesn't see any hope anymore, that's when those terrible whys come and those terrible thoughts come. Man will make extreme sacrifices. Just look at those people flooding up from Central America. They'll do all sorts of hardships, but they're doing it because they expect a blessed end for whatever they're facing. But Moses, I believe, he had his connection with God. And I think, I've heard many testimonies of people that were very, very discouraged, but they simply went into the Word of God and they started looking on these verses that talk about the promises of God, and they received strength to go on. Praise the Lord. And I read this, or came across this thought, that we should gaze on our problems, excuse me, we should glance at our problems and gaze on God. But we sort of get this turned around many times. We glance at God and gaze on our problems. How about it? Think about it. Isn't that the way we oftentimes do? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. But when we get a hold of God, as Moses did, and we come to those hard places where we don't see a way, we've got something, a foundation that many people don't. In Isaiah 43, verse 16, just like to read that very quickly. Isaiah 43, verse 16. Thus saith the Lord, which maketh a way in the sea and a path in the mighty waters. Do you believe in this God this morning? Amen. Which bringeth forth the chariot and horse, the army and the power. They shall lie down together. They shall not rise. They are extinct. They are quenched as a tow. That word quenched as a tow is just like if you snuff out a candle. It's that easy for Pharaoh, for God to just quench Pharaoh's mighty army, and where they're completely exterminated. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now shall it spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. This is the message that God has for us today, that we can look to the Almighty One when there is no way. He will make a way. God is sovereign, and really, this whole thing turned out to be one of the biggest blessings in their lives. Their enemy was exterminated. But you see, we can only see our enemy sometimes. We can only see our problems, and that's what gets us down so many times. But God wants us to start gazing on Him and glancing at our problems. Are you willing to do that today? You willing to try to make that commitment? To gaze on God and glance at your problems. Now, I'm not at all suggesting that we become irresponsible. We have to think about our problems at times. We have to try to find solutions. And God has given us a mind and a brain to think about these things. But when it becomes to a point where we're just wore down, I don't think God wants that of us, does He? That's where we need to get a hold of God. And we come back here to this account. The Lord shall fight for you in verse 14. And he tells Moses there in 15, the Lord said to Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. But lift thou up thy rod and stretch out thine hand over the sea. Divide it, and the children of Israel shall go on dry ground through the midst of the sea. What a blessing. God is able to make a way regardless of what circumstance you're facing at this point, when there is no way. Do you believe that? He did it for them. And I, behold, I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, and they shall follow them. And I will get me honor upon Pharaoh, upon all his host, upon his chariots, upon his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have got me honor upon Pharaoh, upon his chariots, and upon his horsemen. You know, many times God works in ways that He can be glorified. You know, there was a prayer request in our Sunday school this morning about a brother that's a school teacher, and he's been dismissed because of his view on, I think it was homosexuality. Is that correct? It might look like he's at the end of the road. I don't know. I don't think he is. There's a God in heaven. It about looked like Stephen was at the end of the road, wasn't he? When they stoned him, got rid of him. But that was just the open door for Saul to become Paul. And today we're still blessed by that. Praise God. Instead of asking why, ask God what? How about it? And just trust Him. You know, this account is sort of like a storybook ending. Everything turned out all right, didn't it? Well, what about our life? Sometimes it doesn't. Yeah, we could think if God would work such big miracles like this, where he would just part the sea and everything would fall into place, wouldn't that be wonderful? But how many of us have experienced things in our life where it just didn't? And today, yet we're struggling with those things. I'd like to look at an account here in Daniel, the third chapter, verse 17, of the three Hebrew children. And I believe there is so much for us to learn as it relates to that. Daniel 3. Here were three of God's people, and they were also facing a crisis in their lives that looks like it was going to cost their life. There was no way, in a sense. If you consider the odds that were against him, here was this great king Nebuchadnezzar, one of the most powerful kings on earth, a very rich king, very powerful. And if you read some of his history, he was a ruthless king. Nobody would stand in his way ever. And here he had made this big idol, and he was asking everyone to bow down to it. And everyone fell on their faces before it except three young Hebrew children. Three Hebrew children. And he was in his fury. This fury infuriated him to the point where he said, "We're going to burn them alive." And so they made this furnace. They fired up the furnace and said, "I'll give you one more chance." And he gave them another chance, but they still stood. And he was so infuriated that he said, "Heat this furnace seven times hotter than it was ever before." And this is what those young men told him when they were brought face to face with him. It looked like their life was finished. It looked like they had come to the end of the way. It looked like there was nothing left for them anymore. And this is what they said. Verse 16, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we are not careful to answer thee in this matter. If so be our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, he will deliver us out of thine hand, O king. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up." Do you realize, my friends, my dear people, that if in this life there is no way, if you're a child of God, there will be a way of death? We can leave this all behind and enter into the glories of heaven. There will always be a way for God's people. Amen? Amen. And this was Daniel, this was those three people's testimony. So what if things don't turn out here in this life? So what if I have to suffer till the rest of my days? There is a way out after death. That is huge for a person. And this is what the children, this is what those people that don't know God don't have, my friends. Two of my boys were in Honduras just the other week, and they were talking with one of the brethren there. And, of course, they were talking, of course, about this famous subject of COVID, wearing masks and everything else. And this brother, and I say this hesitatingly, and I hope I'm not at all insinuating if you should wear a mask or you shouldn't. But this brother, he doesn't really like to wear a mask this much. And it seems like Honduras is pretty paranoid about this. And so he says, he told my boys, he said, when they talk to him, he said he'll wear a mask if he has to. But some people are so scared of this virus. So he said, you know, when people start talking to him about the scary thing of this COVID, he said, especially if they're unbelievers, he said he'll just tell them, you know what? Beings that sin has the sting of death in it. He said, why aren't you scared of that? Why aren't you afraid to sin? Be sinning every day. You're going to die and go to hell.
He said, if I die, I have a hope to get to heaven. He said, I'm not scared of this COVID thing. I was challenged with that. You see the difference in the hope that a child of God has? We've got a bright future ahead of us, brothers and sisters. This church got a bright future ahead of them. And I just recently read of this account of this young lady, this person. I'm not sure, was it a man or a lady? But I think it was a man. They got him in to give a talk. He had been in the prison in China and for a number of years, and so they got him into their pulpit to share his experiences, and so he started talking, but he kept talking of his wonderful relationship with the Lord, and the preacher said, but we'd like to know how it was to suffer in this prison. Oh, he said, well, he said, yeah, but he said, you know what? He said, I had probably the most wonderful time in my life sitting in that prison because the Lord was so dear to me and so near to me during that suffering. Hallelujah. You know, we look ahead. We don't know for sure where things are going to end up here in the U.S., everything that we're facing. But, oh, my friends, once we get to the point where we suffer, God is there. And we see this exactly in the account of these three friends. When they bound them, and it's interesting, in verse 20, and he commanded the most mighty men that were in his army. He wasn't taking any chances. It was the most powerful, the most strongest men in his army to bind these three men. Nebuchadnezzar was going to be thorough. This king was going to be very Thor in this situation. His most mighty men. It looked like everything was over. They got them, they bound them, and they threw them in the furnace. And the Bible tells us in verse 23, they fell down bound in the midst of the burning fiery furnace. Then Nebuchadnezzar the king was astonished and rose up in haste and spake and said to his counselors, verse 24, did we not cast three men bound into the midst of the fire? They answered and said to the king, true, O king. He answered and said, lo, I see four men loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. There is a way when there is no way. That's when Jesus is with you. Whatever life brings to you, maybe you're suffering from some of the choices you've made in life. Maybe you're going to have to suffer to your grave. I don't know. But Jesus can be with you. There is a way out. After death, we have that glorious hope. But there's a very, very, very important point here in this scripture in verse 23. Those three men fell down. How many of us are fighting against circumstances that have come into our life and have not allowed the Lord to break us and become broken before Him? My friends, I think that's the difference. If we're going to make it or not through some of these circumstances, if we open our hearts to be broken before Him. Those four men were bound. They let themselves be thrown in to become totally broken. They fell down. And I believe whatever life has brought to you this today, if you're willing to fall down before God and become broken and accept those things that God has brought into your life, that's where the Son of God appears and you can become free. Corrie ten Boom, when she was in those Nazi camps, after she was liberated, she had a ministry of reaching out to people that were survivors of the concentration camps. back in World War II. And she makes this statement. She said, the people that were able to forgive were able to get on in life. The people that were not willing to forgive never got ahead in life. She said, it was as simple as that. But it takes a brokenness in our life. It takes a coming before God. Instead of asking why, we need to ask what. What are you trying to tell me? What do you want of my life? And sometimes, in this case, you see God hardened Pharaoh's heart. God's hand was moving and orchestrating the situation for the children of Israel. And God had a plan. In this case, I would tend to feel it was the devil behind it. So who are we to decide? We don't always know, is the devil behind it? Or is it God's hand that these things we're facing and suffering? But we know one thing, that God is sovereign. And he can always, the man that falls down broken and allows God to break him and forgive and just become broken before God, God will always glorify himself. The form of the fourth is like the Son of Man. Do people see Jesus in your circumstance that you're going through today? Do they see a brokenness? Do they see you just being coming before God and crying out, what, Lord? And God in heaven will bless and will just pour out his blessings again and again and again. God always makes a way. You know, if those three Hebrew children would have died, it would have been glorious. Amen? There's a way. The child of God will always have a way, even though he might have to suffer the rest of his life. And we sometimes think that to be God's people, everything needs to fall in place for us, and we love it. And God does sometimes bless us in those, many times, many, many times he blesses us. But not every time. So, the question is to you today, are you willing to ask God what instead of why? Will you believe that there is a way when there is no way? Will you reach out to God and get a hold of his promises like Moses did? That made a difference in Moses' life. Will we get a hold of God to the point that regardless of what we face in life, God can be with us if we become broken before him? He did it for Moses. He did it for Job and the three Hebrew children. In fact, is there any place in the Bible he did not make a way for his people? The answer is faith, patience, and a brokenness and meekness before our Heavenly Father. And there will be a way. May God bless you. Shall we kneel before him in prayer?
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we bow before you. We thank you so much for the privilege of being your children. Thank you for redeeming us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for going with us through life. Oh God, we pray that for each soul here today, that there could be a brokenness before you, that you could work in their hearts and lives, and that you could be glorified in whatever situation they face, circumstance they face. Oh God, we pray that you would just become real to each heart here today. And help us to trust you and to just reach out to you and serve you with all our heart. Bless this congregation. Bless their witness in the community. Bless their families, their preachers, their ministers. Just bless each one here, each visitor. Would you bless each one? Dear God, we just commit our life, our soul, and everything we have into your hands. And again, oh God, we acknowledge and confess that we are so weak at times. Just help us to reach out to you again and again and to trust in you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.